The first question we need to answer is, do you want the blue pill or the red pill? If you take the blue pill, you will only be able to see the spin. If you take the red pill, you'll see the truth behind the spin. I know you want the red pill. Let's dive in.
On the front page of the Herald.
Mistakes were made.
It's been failures.
Did no surprises.
Were not fully and properly investigated.
That was a very, very unfortunate failure.
Look, I think we could have done better.
With tears in their eyes.
Welcome to another episode of We Were Children, a Dilworth School Survivors vlog. Today we're going to talk about Dilworth's response to this monumental abuse disaster where hundreds of boys have been abused sexually, physically, psychologically and emotionally. The big question I think everyone wants to know, is Dilworth looking after the hundreds of boys who were horribly abused in their care? I'll let you decide after you watch this episode. Today, Dilworth School has made some great changes with the child safety policy. A lot of survivors would say, why didn't they do that back when they caught Peter Taylor, who provided to the school a list of names of who he had abused? You would think someone on the Dilworth Trust Board might have had some common sense and said, how do we prevent this from happening again? The other problem you need to consider with a child safe policy is that it takes 22 years for a child sex abuse victim to report it.
Australian Royal Commission of Inquiry into Institutional Responses to Child Sexual Abuse found that the average time for a survivor to disclose child sexual abuse is at least 22 years. This is largely due to survivors of sexual abuse repressing their memories of the abuse, which mental health professionals have confirmed in hundreds of cases.
So we won't really know if Dilworth's child safety policy is really working until 2040. So who initiated the child safety policy back in 2018? Would you be surprised to find out it was actually a sexual abuse survivor? Well, it was. It takes an abuse survivor to get the Dilworth Trust Board to wake up and smell the roses. Neil Harding, in early April 2018, met with John Wayne, chairman of the Dilworth Trust Board of Trustees, in a cafe in Parnell. Neil wrote to the Dilworth Trust Board a report on his survivor account and recommendations on a child safety policy. He worked hard for 6 months to get the Trust Board interested in his ideas for child safety. Neil collaborated with the Trust Board for 18 months on a child safety program. When the Dilworth Trust Board announced the new child safe policy, they implied it was a Dilworth Trust Board initiative and took all the credit for themselves. The Dilworth Trust Board never acknowledged Neil Harding's initiative, commitment and work. Another big question is, has the old school mentality and culture they call the Dilworth effect, which is ingrained into boys who then grow up, with a few of them becoming trustees on the Trust Board, thus passing the Dilworth effect on to the next generation. So who were the Dilworth Trust Board trustees that developed the Dilworth response?
Aaron Snodgrass. Aaron is a Dilworth old boy and joined the Trust Board in 2013 before becoming chairman in 2018. He is Chief Financial Officer of Eastland Group, a Gisborne-based infrastructure company, and has previously worked as a chartered accountant at PwC and Deutsche Bank. Aaron is a Chartered Accountant Fellow and a Chartered Fellow of the Institute of Directors. Aaron was a member and treasurer of the Dilworth Old Boys Association Council. Simon Curran. Simon is a Dilworth old boy who joined the Trust Board in 2015. He is the co-founder and CEO of Shine Limited, an Auckland-based creative business consultancy. Simon works extensively with entrepreneurs, enterprises, schools and communities to harness the creative potential of their people. Peter Alexander. Peter is a property investment expert who joined the Trust Board in 2017. He is an independent property investment and development advisor and a fellow of the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors. Peter has previously held senior executive roles at a number of publicly listed companies, including Auckland International Airport, Stride Property Group, Goodman, Property for Industry and Sky City Entertainment. He is a past chairman of Community Housing Provider Homes of Choice Limited and a past director of HLC Limited, formerly Hobsonville Land Co. Limited. Leo Falaki. Leo is senior partner at PwC and joined the Dilworth Trust Board in 2022. His governance experience includes board membership of New Zealand Opera, the Cause Collective Trust and Tupu Toa Trust. He has also been an independent member of the audit committees for Oranga, Tamariki and Counties Manukau, DHB. Jonathan Mason. Jonathan joined the Dilworth Trust Board in March 2019. Jonathan also serves on the board of companies including Vector, Zespri, Westpac and Air New Zealand. Previously, he was the Chief Financial Officer at Fonterra and the Chief Financial Officer at Carter Holt Harvey.
So how do you get to be a trustee on the Dilworth Trust Board? Well, they don't advertise, so it must be the old what you know, but rather who you know process. So what do you need to have to be a trustee on the Dilworth Trust Board? Actually, Derek Firth answered that question last October at the Royal Commission.
There are only six trustees. We were very hard-nosed in business.
Hard-nosed businessman. Derek Firth also confirmed at the Royal Commission when he was told by Miss Anderson that his actions reflected that he had no understanding of the impact of trauma. Mr. Firth totally agreed.
But now, the point that people make complaints late as an excuse for difficulties that have arisen in the person's life, do you think that perhaps clearly doesn't illustrate an understanding of the impact of trauma on someone's life?
I totally agree.
So back in Derek Firth's time, the board was made up of CEOs of large corporations who were hard-nosed businessmen and who had a lack of understanding of the impact of trauma. Today we have the same profile on the board, hard-nosed businessmen. Do they also have a lack of understanding of the impact of trauma? Let's have a look at what Mr. Snodgrass said at the Royal Commission about this.
Aaron, you will have seen this document in the bundle, I think. It's a Office of the Children's Guardian in New South Wales with engaging sensitively with survivors of abuse, a guide for faith organisations. Have you seen this document?
Yes, I have.
Yep. And just turning to page 22 of the document, it's referring to these six principles of trauma-informed practice. The first one is safety. Second one, trustworthiness and transparency. The third one, collaboration and mutuality. Four, empowerment, voice and choice. Five, peer support. And six, cultural, historical and gender issues. And you can see in that principle relating to collaboration and mutuality that it starts from a position of recognising the abuse of power as paramount and the deliberate harm of children. And so that those should seek to reverse those by identifying and balancing power differences to recognise the value and contributions of survivors. So in terms of your process of developing your redress terms of reference, to what extent do you think this collaboration and mutuality with survivors has been a part of your process?
Look, I think we could have done better. And one of the things that we had to weigh up here was getting a program together that was timely, that was responsive to survivors' needs at this time.
The first Dilworth Response program launched was the Listening Service. This is an excellent program and is providing a lot of support to survivors who are still suffering today from the effects of trauma. This was only launched because of the public awareness from Operation Beverly, and the school needed to be seen doing the right thing in the public's eyes. Otherwise, if they really cared about the psychology of sexual abuse victims, why did they not offer Vaughan Sexton psychology support back in 2018, where he had his paedophile Keith Dixon convicted, where the Dilworth Trust Board went to the trouble of obtaining name suppression, denying survivors justice? Again, Reverend Taylor provided a list of boys who he said needed counselling. The Dilworth Trust Board ignored the request for counselling. Let's have a look at the redress program. The first time I heard about a proposed redress program was in September 2021, a few months after the announcement of the Dilworth class action. The announcement was a video presentation on the Dilworth Old Boys Association Facebook page by Aaron Snodgrass, chair of the Dilworth Trust Board. Mr. Snodgrass said they would research best practice both in New Zealand and internationally and have the new redress program ready mid-2022. I started questioning in the Facebook group the school's knowledge of the pedophiles, and I was thrown out of the Facebook group. This was rather upsetting at the time because it felt like I'd just been expelled by Dilworth School. This was personal and made me very angry. Other survivors were thrown out of the Dilworth Old Boys Association for asking questions as well. The president of the Old Boys Association, Steve Brown, supported survivors in the Facebook group, courts and the Royal Commission. He too was ousted by the association's council, even though he was democratically elected. The Old Boys Association is supposed to support old boys, but its abuse survivors are suddenly like a virus that needed to be eradicated, as we might infect the newly graduated students. So if Dilworth really cared about old boys who were abused while in their care, why not announce the development of a redress program a year earlier when Operation Beverly was announced? Maybe it's a coincidence that 3 months after the class action finds a pathway to justice through the Human Rights Commission that Dilworth announces a redress program. I'll leave that one for you to decide. Let's have a look at the collaboration between Dilworth and survivors that resulted in developing a meaningful redress program. Or is it? Collaboration was done via an online survey. The survivors could make suggestions in the surveys, but were never responded to in any way. For example, they never asked the survivors about the revised financial cap in the second survey. Dilworth are promoting the benefits of the minority rather than the majority to make the redress program look better than it is. I'll give you some examples. Let's have a look at Aaron Snodgrass's comment to the Royal Commission last October on peer-on-peer sexual abuse.
Boy-on-boy sexual abuse, if it was known by the school and not acted upon, is covered in the program.
Only a couple of survivors fit into that criteria. The majority of survivors of peer-on-peer sexual abuse are not covered by the redress program. What Mr. Snodgrass should have said is peer-on-peer sexual abuse is not covered. In extinguishing circumstances, it may be covered if it was reported and the school failed to prevent it from happening. In the first survey, the financial cap was $230,000. In the second survey, the financial cap went up to $300,000, but only in extinguishing circumstances. For the majority of survivors, the cap actually went down to $200,000, $30,000 less than the first survey. Dilworth are implying the cap went up.
So in coming up with the cap, we took advice, we looked at other programs around the world, and we came up with a number. We went out for feedback, and the feedback was that we needed to take another look at the level, and we increased it. And that's how we got to the level that we have.
The majority of survivors now have a cap of 200,000, 30,000 less than the first survey. What Mr. Snodgrass should have said at the Royal Commission was, after the surveys, we put the cap down to the majority of the survivors, and to a minority of survivors, we put the cap up. We never collaborated with survivors about the revised cap. Three of the trustees are accountants. The capital outlay for the redress program actually remained the same between the two surveyed caps. The bean counters just took beans out of one bucket and put them into another bucket. The Dilworth Trust Board says they investigated programs internationally, but only investigated courts in New Zealand. Why not investigate courts internationally?
We've looked at what other programs around the world have done. We've looked at what courts in New Zealand have awarded.
I think they did investigate international courts and didn't want to include the results in their calculations because it would drastically affect the outcome. This is why. These are relatively recent historical child abuse settlements in Australia. 2.4 million, Catholic Church. 2.7 million, Geelong College. 3 million, Wesley College. 5.3 million, institutional child abuse payout. So why don't we get these kind of settlements from the courts here in New Zealand? Because of a six-year limitation to bring about a civil case. So if you're sexually abused at age 10, you have to make your civil claim to the court before you turn 16. As I covered earlier, the Australian Royal Commission of Inquiry into Institutional Responses to Child Sex Abuse found that the average time for a survivor to disclose child sexual abuse is at least 22 years. This is why the Royal Commission in Australia recommended removing the limitations in Australia, and now child sex abuse survivors are getting meaningful compensation for life lost. Since the Royal Commission last October, has there been any communication or collaboration with survivors since the class action asked to come to our waka, and where Aaron Snodgrass said we could have done better with collaboration? No, not a word. Let's have a look at what's going on with the current redress program. Now, this is what Mr. Snodgrass said at the Royal Commission about providing redress now.
Yes, the point of distinction I'm drawing is it's quite different. A consultation process in which you receive feedback is very, very different from a collaborative process of designing something from the ground up with survivors.
I acknowledge
that. You accept that. And you understand that that's the concern that's been outlined around the process that the class action group outlined in its opening address to the inquiry yesterday, that it's a process concern around the, effectively, as I've interpreted it, that this lack of collaboration with survivors in the design of the redress process has contributed to the situation where the school and the survivors are not in the same waka.
I'm disappointed to hear that that survivor group don't believe that there was no consultation. But what I'm trying to do is to give the Commission an understanding of why we've moved at pace to put this program in place. We're trying to bridge the formation of this program and the formation of Porotumu Toru Whānui, so that we can provide meaningful redress to old boy survivors now.
Mr. Barker, the Dilworth lawyer, even explained to the Royal Commission Clause 11 of the redress terms of reference in more detail.
Clause 11, where the survivor can make an application for redress prior to the inquiry being initiated. But
just to confirm, Mr. Barker, these are the terms of reference of the
Dilworth redress scheme. It allows survivors to make an application for redress, have it considered and dealt with then and then. They can make one for redress, have it held in abeyance until the inquiry is determined, or they can make one after the inquiry if they wish to do so. And it also expressly includes the ability for, if the redress panel makes the determination prior to the inquiry, they've got the ability to revisit redress awards after the inquiry has come out. So it was an attempt, as Mr. Snodgrass indicated, to try and give people who wanted redress now the ability to seek that redress now, and if people wanted to seek it later, then they could seek it later.
How can anyone promise traumatised survivors redress and then not provide it? I kid you not. The redress program commenced in August 2022. Has anyone actually been paid redress yet? I carried out a poll in the Dilworth Survivors Facebook group, which has 50 plus Dilworth abuse survivors in it. According to the poll, no one has been offered or paid redress to date that we know of. So why have Dilworth not paid redress to any survivors? Maybe it's because they're strapped for cash. Let's have a look at their latest financial report. According to the latest published report, which is for the 2021 year, income derived from rents and investments, 260 million. Expenses. Costs of running the school, approximately 30 million. Other expenses, approximately 13 million. Here they set aside in expenses 43 million for historical abuse. For example's sake, as they haven't paid that yet, let's put that back into the accounts. This means they made a surplus for that year of 217 million. For those that don't know what surplus is, it's pretty much the same as profit. As Dilworth is a charitable trust, it doesn't pay tax. So surplus is the same as net profit. Dilworth could easily afford to pay every survivor 1 million, and they would still have a surplus net profit of 87 million. 1 million is not even one third of the average court settlements in Australia. Aren't our lives worth the same as the lives of Australians? So why don't they pay it? Because they don't have to. The six-year limitation prevents historical sexual abuse cases in New Zealand getting to court. So consequently, Dilworth are exploiting the limitation laws. I heard that the redress panel was not making offers of redress, so I wrote to the redress administrator that they needed to communicate with survivors as to what was happening. Their response was a letter to the survivors who are registered in the redress program.
Redress program update. Interim award available for qualifying applicants. The Dilworth Independent Redress Panel had expected the report of the Dilworth Independent Inquiry to be delivered at the end of 2022 and then May 2023, but the inquiry recently advised that its report will now not be published until the end of June 2023. The panel appreciates the work of the Dilworth Independent Inquiry has required more time than previously anticipated as a result of the number of participants and the complexity of the issues to be considered. Therefore, the panel will not make a determination of any applications for redress until some time after the publication of the inquiry's report. This is because the findings of the report may be relevant to any determinations the panel may make. The panel is conscious of the impact of this additional delay and to address this concern has decided to offer an interim payment of $10,000 to those applicants for whom a redress application has been lodged and who satisfy the criteria set out in the attached schedule to this letter under qualifying applications.
So basically, without collaboration with the survivors, the panel has decided to ignore paragraph 11 of the redress terms of reference, which states...
Clause 11 of the redress terms of reference. To allow a survivor to apply for redress before the report independent inquiry is published, a survivor will be able to either A. File their application and have it determined by the panel without waiting for the findings of the independent inquiry, or B. File their application but have it held in abeyance until the panel has considered the findings of the independent inquiry and any new information relevant to the survivor's application.
If it was the case the panel was worried the inquiry report was going to affect the redress cap, the terms of reference already allowed for this.
Clause 12 of the redress terms of reference. After the independent inquiry's report is published, the panel may review any determination made in accordance with Clause 11A above and make a further offer of redress to a survivor if it considers it is appropriate to do so in light of the inquiry's findings.
They also said the panel is conscious of the impact of this additional delay to address this concern, has decided to offer an interim payment of $10,000 to those applicants for whom redress application has been lodged and who satisfy the criteria. I did a poll in the Survivors Facebook group to see how many survivors satisfied the criteria. Only 8% qualified, 51% never qualified, and 41% were never contacted. There are survivors who trusted these statements and relied on accessing redress immediately, as their current situation warranted it. Survivors have been misled, and it's totally unacceptable. They threw survivors a 10k bone because of the waiting time until after the inquiry report is released. Again, something the majority of survivors can't have. If after the Royal Commission last October you have decided not to pay redress until after the inquiry, you should have collaborated this with survivors and made a significant preliminary payment. It's a total lack of respect to leave survivors hanging, not knowing for 8 months. Paragraph 17 of the redress terms of reference stated,
Clause 17 of the redress terms of reference. If the survivor has engaged in the inquiry, they will be entitled to have access to and contact with the same support person for both the inquiry and redress program.
The wellness people from the inquiry have not been offered full-time jobs with redress. After the inquiry report is published, consequently, paragraph 17 can't apply anymore. These people are survivors' go-to people when they want an answer to a question about the Dilworth response. Treating psychologists don't know the finer workings of the programs, and some survivors only speak to their psychologist once every fortnight. Survivors are not being treated equally. If you live in Auckland, you can go before the redress panel in person. If you live overseas, you have to use Zoom. Obviously, the bean counters don't want to pay travel costs. These changes have been made without proper consultation or collaboration with the majority of survivors. False promises of redress and moving the goalposts could be extremely traumatising and triggering for some survivors. I myself personally am meeting with a redress facilitator in the near future. I thought I should get a report to show what effect the abuse has had on my life, so who better to ask than my listening service psychologist to provide me with a report that I could provide the facilitator. He was told by the Dilworth Listening Service not to provide the report, as it's not required, and it would be unfair to other survivors who don't have a report. I failed to see how I present my case affects other survivor cases. Some survivors will choose to get their own report done with a forensic psychiatrist, which is what I'm going to do now, just out of the principle of it, and not allowing Dilworth to control the narrative. Some survivors, because they're taking certain medication, or at the right moment might be in a psychological high and might say to a facilitator, when asked how the abuse affected their life, could respond by saying, it's all good. Yet their treating psychologist would paint a completely different picture. Shouldn't the real truth about how the trauma has affected the lives of survivors be presented in any redress application? It's about empowering survivors to present their application any way they want to the redress panel. I decided to do a poll in the Dilworth Survivors Facebook group of over 50 survivors to assess whether survivors are happy with the current Dilworth redress program. According to the poll in the Dilworth Survivors Facebook group, 90% say no. What compassion did Derek first show Vaughan Sexton after Vaughan Sexton won a conviction against his paedophile Keith Dixon? In a letter he wrote, he showed no compassion. In fact, it was the complete opposite. He criticised Vaughan Sexton's intentions for the contact. So the makeup of the board today is no different to the board in Derek first time. As he quoted at the Royal Commission, hard-nosed in business. These people, as Derek Firth has shown, have no care or compassion for survivors, and that's why today the redress program is nothing more than a commercial transaction, and is why a poll showed 90% of survivors are not happy with the redress program. And as in another poll, 75% of survivors have a vote of no confidence in the current board's ability to design a meaningful redress program. You have commercial juggernauts on the board who literally treat the survivors as an operating expense. These guys don't get to be CFOs because they have care and compassion. They get these roles because they are, as Derek Firth stated at the Royal Commission, they're hard-nosed businessmen. Having these guys design a redress program is like having a brain surgeon work on your car. I believe if the Dilworth Trust Board really cared about doing the right thing for survivors, they should gain approval of the redress program from the High Court, that it is a meaningful and reflects compensation for life lost. On the 11th of June 1999, the Dilworth Trust Board applied to the High Court for approval for a new scheme, a study to investigate feasibility of possible facilities for girls. Again, on the 9th of February 2022, they applied to the High Court to vary a charitable trust. The approval of the scheme extending and varying the powers of the trustees and varying the mode of administration of the assets of the Dilworth Trust Board. Judge Carole Shaw, Chair of the Abuse and Care Royal Commission of Inquiry, asked Mr. Barker, Dilworth's lawyer, about Roger Allison, who was not a student of Dilworth but was abused by the Dilworth Scout leader Richard Galloway on Dilworth property. Let's have a look at this discussion at the Royal Commission.
The next question I just wanted to briefly address is just there was a comment made about the fact that the redress program relates only to old boys, and I just thought I'd give some background to why that is. You know, one of the great strengths of Dilworth is that it has operates under this trust structure, which gives it tremendous freedom that is probably not shared by many other educational institutions, but it does impose some restrictions, and that ultimately the trustees are trustees in law and equity and have to follow the rules of a trustee. And one of the difficulties is that the trust established a school, but it then has an express power to help old boys who have left the school. And that's really been the source of power for the redress program itself. But unfortunately, it is a power that's limited to old boys, which is the where that restriction has come from. It's really a trust-based restriction. And that probably distinguishes us Dilworth from other entities because they don't have absolute freedom. They've got a lot of freedom, but the hard limits they have are hard limits.
Yes. It's an interesting point. I mean, obviously, the trustee... There must be some sort of third-party liability, though. I mean, I'm just thinking, if a burglar came on the property and injured them, so I don't know. Think about it.
Yes, it is a difficult issue.
It's a difficult issue, but you can see, can't you, just from the problem of one man, one survivor, who literally fell through the cracks and mercifully has been saved, picked up by the Anglicans, but not all will possibly be in that boat. So I think it is something that's worth looking at. Thank you.
Now, Dilworth, ask yourself what James and Isabella Dilworth would do about Roger Allison if they were here today. I'm sure you would agree they would accommodate Mr. Allison. Do what needs to be done. Apply to the High Court for approval to pay redress to Mr. Allison. And while you're at the High Court, ask the court if your redress program should have a cap or should it be left up to the redress panel to decide meaningful redress. Well, there is only a couple of months for the release of the independent inquiry report. I think there is a few ex-Dilworth staff who are going to be doing a Keanu Reeves in the Matrix. Please subscribe to this channel and thank you for watching.
If Isabella Dilworth was alive today, she would